So good evening. Thank you very much for this nice introduction and for your invitation. I don't have much time, so just let's go. Why do we want to study comets? They are small, they are very black, they have no rings, no moons, they may look a bit boring, but actually they are really cool. Why? Because they are as old as the Earth, they are deep frozen, they are building blocks of planets, and they may be a source for terrestrial water and organics. So if you want to study, if you want to investigate the origins of the solar system, that's the thing you need to study. In two words, that's why Rosetta was sent there. Rosetta is a pretty heavy baby, 3,000 kilograms at launch. Half of this weight is just the propellant. And inside everything which is remaining, we have the payload, so that's the scientific instruments which we want to send in space. And they represent only 165 kilograms for the orbiter and 26.7 kilograms for the lander. Altogether, we have 21 instruments, 11 on the orbiter and 10 on the lander. I'm working on one of the, as you said, I'm working on one of the 11 instruments of the orbiter. I will talk about this later. This is pretty important here, the solar panels, because Rosetta is the first probe. Rosetta has many firsts, but one of the firsts is that Rosetta is the first probe to go so far away, almost next to Jupiter or near to the Jupiter orbit, with only solar panels. That will explain many things later. And we have 24 thrusters, yeah, so that it can go right, left, up, down, do some loopings and just have fun up there. So, the launch was theoretically planned on the 13th of January 2003, and the target was Virtanen. Something not that great happened, end of 2002. The Ariane 5 launch, one of them failed, so everything was postponed. Of course, Virtanen didn't wait, so we had to find another target. Of course, when I say we, it's not me, it's the people at that time at ESA who decided this. So the new target was Churyumov-Gerasimenko, and the new launch date was the 2nd of March 2004. Now, I'm going to try to summarize 12 years within 2 minutes, so hold on, it may be pretty intense, especially at the end. So the launch was on the 2nd of March 2004, it's there, here. And, you know, to get a higher speed in space, you don't have too many possibilities. One of them is to do some flybys. That means when you fly close to a planet, for instance here, the Earth, when you fly close to this planet, you steal a little bit of speed. So Rosetta did it 4 times. 3 times next to the Earth, 1 time next to Mars. This was, by the way, the first selfie that Rosetta ever took. Then, second Earth flyby, when Osiris, a big camera on Rosetta, took a picture of the South Pole. Here is Lutetia. So each time we go further away and further away. Here was Churyumov-Gerasimenko. Then here, third Earth gravity assist on the 13th of November. Then the speed was high enough to go really far away and to already be on the trajectory to get the comet. On the way, we analyzed the asteroid Lutetia. Little break. We go back. And here is Lutetia there. And as I said, the solar panel didn't give enough energy. That's why here we entered into a deep space hibernation, which was pretty stressful for everybody anyway. So here we had no control, we couldn't do anything. But there, in January of this year, we saw this signal. Many people were really happy because that meant Rosetta was fine and awake. And this is what we saw, beginning of August. We understood pretty well what we had to deal with. And we were just showing off with many nice pictures starting August. This is now where we are, a few weeks after this. The lander delivery a few weeks ago. This is now the future, of course. If everything goes well, and everything will go well, like everything was well until now, so anyway. In August, we will be at the closest point to the sun, and the nominal end of the mission should be around here in December 2015. Now, I will come back a little bit earlier, when we saw for the first time this thing. Nobody did expect such a shape with something that looks like a head here, with a neck, a big body, a big hole here, or yes, some interesting features, let's say, over there and everywhere, and here. So as soon as we arrived next to this comet, all the instruments of the orbiter and some of the instruments from the lander started to analyze and to get some interesting results from this thing. Among these instruments, one of them, one I'm working on, ROSINA, which stands for Rosetta Orbiter Spectrometer for Ion and Neutral Analysis, consists of three sensors. One pressure sensor, COPS, and two mass spectrometers. I will talk shortly about each of them. COPS, the pressure sensor, basically measures the neutral gas density, that's just the activity of the comet, which it serves as a safety instrument aboard Rosetta, so that means it's a really important instrument, because it informs in real time the other instruments about the surrounding pressure, allowing these instruments to switch themselves off in case this pressure will be too high. So in Bern, we have the power to switch all the other instruments off. It's pretty cool. And we have these two mass spectrometers. I will just talk about them a bit later. About the results from the first one here, COPS. Here is a plot which shows the density. So this is given by COPS. This is basically the number of particles which we get in our instrument with respect to the latitude and the distance, the inverted distance actually. Here, the higher the curve, the closer to the comet. And the latitude is just where you're looking at the comet. What COPS measures, what the pressure sensor measures, is only everything which gets out from what we see, from the area facing the comet. From the area of the face of the comet facing the spacecraft. Sorry. So from the beginning on, with beginning, I mean beginning of August. This is the time when we actually started to see, or to smell, in our case, the comet. Beginning of August, we observed a clear correlation with distance, because here it's increasing as it's increasing here, and with latitude. I will zoom on this area, if it wants to zoom. Yes. And once again here, we see some seasonal effects with a summer hemisphere, which would be this part here on top, which is very active, and a more moderate area here below, the winter hemisphere, which would be in blue, with seasonal variations and so on. If we zoom a little bit again, we may see other features. I would just talk here about diurnal variations. And the rotation period of the comet is 12.4 hours, and that's exactly the time we have between two peaks. That means every other peak corresponds either to the day side or to the night side. So that's really something, the comet is really heterogeneous. We have some parts which outgasses much more than others. Depending on the orientation of the axis of the comet, we have some winter outgassing, some summer outgassing. So we have many things we can study, and that's good for us. So that's about COPS. Now, I will not go too much into details in the mass spectrometers, but I cannot resist. I want to tell you a bit how it works inside. So DFMS is one of the two mass spectrometers. So in order to simplify, I did just put here some elements. The particles, or the atoms and molecules we want to measure, enter this thing here. We have some heavy elements, so atoms and molecules, and some light ones. The light ones are green, the heavy ones are red, just in this example. So that we can make them move inside our instruments, we have to ionize them. That means we just get rid of some electrons. They then have an electric charge, and we can move them in the instrument. So first, we ionize them. Then we select them according to their energy. Here, we give them an energy. All the particles are given the same energy. All the ions here are given the same energy. And because they don't have the same mass, when they go here, this is a big magnet which makes which deviates the ions. So the light ones would do this, and the heavy ones would do up, would go this direction. If we increase the energy we give to these ions, then the light ones, the other way around. If we decrease the energy we give to the ions, then the light ones would do tonk, and the heavy ones would go nicely on the detector. So DFMS cannot see all the masses together. it can see only a few masses. I will show a spectrum now, actually. This is typically what we get. We see only a part of everything we have around the instrument, but we see it very well. I will show you afterwards with Ertov, the other mass spectrometer. We see many things, but not that well. But we see much more. So this is typically a DFMS spectrum at mass 30. And we can resolve many, many things. This was probably, this was taken into a lab. So this is not the comet yet. This will come really soon. Now about Ertov, how it works. So again, really quickly, just I will simplify it with a few elements. It's in German. I wasn't brave enough to change it. Here, it's much more simple. And the idea here, we have no magnet, but we will measure the time the atoms and molecules need to travel through the instrument. So first step, as usual, now you know, we have to ionize them, then we can move them. And we measure the time they need to travel from there to there. Cool, the green one is winning. It's because it's lighter. So and then we measure the time they need. The first ones are the heavy ones, the light ones. Oh, I have some troubles this evening. So the first ones are the light ones, and the heavy ones come afterwards. Of course, this is way too simple. This is what we get in real life. Once again, this is from a lab, but we have the time here and intensity there. And all the peaks you see here are a different mass. That means a different atom or molecule, the heavy ones being there. Typically, this should be water here. Okay, now about what we see in space. So this is a combination of many DFMS spectra. Do you remember? One DFMS spectrum is only one mass. So this would be one spectrum, 20 seconds. This is the combination of many, roughly 35, maybe it's written somewhere, DFMS spectra. So a comet consists of water, CO, CO2. This we know. Now, of course, we want to go into the details. To go into the details, we need here to put a log scale because we see much better the small peaks. And for me, this is pretty impressive because we have a peak on every single mass, almost. Yeah, don't look here. But that means we really have a lot of things. And actually, in our team, we didn't expect so many things from the beginning on. Now we are still a bit far away from the sun, only 3.5, it's getting closer. But these spectra, in August, we were at 3.5 AU, so 3.5 times the distance Earth-Sun, from the sun. And we didn't expect the comet to be that active. But even though, we could see a lot of things. So we, that means also a lot of work, but yeah. We like it. Another way to put it, here is a table with everything we were expecting on the left, which has been from the literature, which has been observed already in other comets, and this is what ROSINA already detected. So almost everything is green, and we also detected some other molecules which had never seen before in comets. So this is all about ROSINA. I'm sure I'm already done with the time, but anyway, I will try to speed up a little bit because it was not fast enough. So I would like to talk now about Philae. So landing on a comet, it's of course very difficult, not only because you have to do a lot of maneuvers in every direction, but also because the landing site is not really a nice flat slope. You see, you have a lot of bumps and so on. But anyway, Philae was designed to be able to land on a comet. As I said, you have 10 instruments on Philae, on the lander, including many cameras, a bit everywhere. You have some temperature sensors, some microphones. There are some mass spectrometers, a X-ray spectrometer. There's a little hammer. And there's a drilling system to get a sample and to distribute it to the other experiments. I'm sure I'm forgetting something, but concert, it's also pretty nice. It's used to sound the nucleus of the comet. There's one part here, it's an antenna, actually. One part on the lander and another part on the orbiter. And with these two antennas, you can probe the inside of the nucleus. So when you have the comet here, the lander here, when the orbiter does this, it just scans what's inside. It was really helpful also, you will see why, in other circumstances. So it looks nice. I will skip a part of this video. So at the beginning, everything was fine. All the orbits were defined. The release was really smooth. Of course, Philae took a picture of Rosetta, and Rosetta took a picture of Philae. And this descent was pretty long or pretty short. It was 7 hours. So 7 hours is a bit too long, so I will just try to skip this a little bit. And what we heard, because we could actually hear what happened during the landing because of the microphones which are installed in the legs of Philae, and we could hear, I tried to be synchronized. No, I'm not synchronized, it's a failure. Anyway, we heard this. Ah, boom! I do it again because I love it. No, I won't do it again. Oh, it was much better in my bathroom. So, let's do it again. Hop, check. Ah, good. So, this is not really a smooth surface. We were actually expecting anything, but we were expecting more something like, not snow, but powder, something a bit soft with a layer of dust. And actually, we were even afraid that the lander would just go poof into 1 meter of dust and that there would be no sun any longer on the solar panels. But this, if I can do it without doing something stupid, this doesn't sound like something smooth. It's really kaboom. So that may be one of the reasons why what you see here didn't really happen. It didn't went smoothly there. It did rebound. Bounced, and this you heard. Maybe you heard that there was 3 touchdowns. This is not true. There were 4, actually. So it's getting better every day. So just before doing this nice sound, Osiris, the camera from Rosetta, observed the lander at 15:14 and so on a bit later. And then, oh, surprise, Philae here, which was supposed to go there. By the way, it was really, really accurate. They managed to land the lander 10 meters away from the predicted landing site and with only 1 minute delay. So 1 minute over 8 hours and 10 meters over 10th of kilometers, it's not that bad. And if you count the travel from the Earth, it's wow. Anyway. So this was before the touchdown and after the touchdown. Surprise, there's no Philae. Philae was here playing leapfrog on the surface. And now the problem is to know where Philae went. And this is why CONCERT was really helpful in this case. So CONCERT, it's this experiment which has 2 antennas and you can sound the nucleus. But in this case, they did change a little bit their measurements so that they could triangulate the position of the spacecraft, of the lander. Sorry. And this is roughly where Philae should be right now, sleeping nicely. This is 1 kilometer away on a 4 kilometer diameter body. That's pretty far away. So we were lucky that it just did 1, 2, 3, 4, and not 1, 2, 3, woo! So, yeah, to land a lander on a comet, we need technology, but we also need a lot of luck. I'm soon finished. I'm sorry about the delays. So I hope you've seen these pictures already on the web. Unfortunately, I cannot show much more, but they are really interesting because here, it's very, very dark. It has been overexposed here, of course, but yeah, it's really, yeah, I wouldn't like to be there actually, but yeah, it's really dark on one side. You have this very nice picture I will show just afterwards, the sky over there, the horizon here, but basically we are like in a hole or hanging to a cliff, so that's not the best place to be, but still, we are on a comet. And I really like, of course, as everybody else, I really like this picture because you have something really, really old as the Earth, if you were here at the beginning of the presentation, along with a feat which has been, or something which has been built by humans. So that's pretty cool. So just to conclude with these next 2 slides, now the status of Philae. At least 9 out of 10 instruments worked without any technical issue. But Churyumov-Gerasimenko, the comet, didn't really cooperate. For instance, SD2 is the drilling, is this little arm which drills and gives the samples to some other instruments. Actually, the surface was so hard that they are not sure they took a sample. This has to be analyzed and this will come in the next weeks, but maybe it was so hard that they couldn't really get a sample. And also with MOPUS, once again, the comet was really hard. They had 3 levels. Gentle one, tok tok tok. Mupu, sorry, it's the hammer which is supposed to measure the hardness of the floor of the comet, of the surface. So it's basically a hammer with a lot of sensors on it. they had three levels of strength. The first one, toc toc toc, didn't penetrate. Okay, let's try the second one, toc toc toc, nothing. The third one, the last one, nothing happened. They had the emergency mode, level 4. All the engineers said, no, don't use it, or only in case of emergencies. This wasn't a case of emergency, because you are here, you have 57 hours, it would have been a failure not to try. So they tried the level 4, it's your boom, boom, and they tried for 7 minutes, but it didn't penetrate, and after 7 minutes, of course, it broke. But it would have been a failure not to try. And actually, we learned a lot. We learned a lot of these from this, because we didn't expect something so hard. And we know the strength of the hammer. So from this, knowing that we do not penetrate, maybe we did a few centimeters, this is still under investigation. I mean, we learned a lot on the properties of the comets. So we got all the data. We were impressed by the battery, who lasted a bit longer than expected, and the scientists, including me, even if I'm not really part of the NANDA, I'm really happy. Now, and I will finish with this, the next steps, there would still be a lot of things to do with Philae if it ever wakes up. It's not really as simple as just, okay, you've heard we landed in a hole or something, a place really dark. It's not as easy as to think that if we have half the quantity of predicted sun, we would just need two times, we would just need twice the time to charge the battery. Actually, we need a minimum energy from the sun, because we need to warm up the batteries first, then there's a lot of procedures, and then the batteries start to be recharged. So we need a minimum limit, minimum quantity of energy. And if we don't have it, maybe it will never wake up. The other side of being in a hole is that actually the sun was supposed to be too strong in March next year, probably, or maybe later. Maybe the lander would survive much longer because it's protected and under nice shadow. And of course, and that's more personal, there's a lot of things to do again, and this is only the beginning for the orbiter. The mission will last until December 2015, and we are only at the beginning. The comet is not really active yet. It's a bit, but not completely. It will become really active for Christmas, so I will have some nice holidays, and then it will keep going for at least 1 year. So the lander landed, did everything it had to do, but even if it doesn't wake up, there will still be a lot of new results in the following month with the orbiter. I'm really sorry, 10 minutes? Yeah, roughly. So thank you very much.